Well, hello there. This lesson, we're going to talk about definite integrals by substitution. You already know what integrals by substitution are. This is a definite integral by substitution. You know what definite integrals are. This is a mix of the two. So the rules on how to do these problems to compare this to regular old integrals don't change. You're still going to pick a u and then du dx and all that fun stuff. And you're going to come up with an integral, but at the very end, you're going to plug in two separate values, subtract the one from the other, just like you did before. So nothing's changed. All right. So I'm going to pick a u such that it looks like its derivative is floating somewhere else in the problem. I'm going to let that guy right there be my u because it looks like 8x minus 1 is probably the derivative of 4x squared minus x. So I'm going to say u equals 4x squared minus x. So its derivative, du dx, is going to equal 8x minus 1. I have to solve this for dx. So I'm going to do the old switcheroo and have 8x minus 1 go in the denominator and dx be on the right side. So it'll look like this. And now I can do some substitution. I'm going to rewrite this guy up here as the integral between 2 and 0, or 0 and 2, however you want to read it, of 8x minus 1 e to the u, because we now turn u into that, so I'm replacing things, e to the u, and instead of dx, I'm going to write out du over 8x minus 1. Now, whenever we do this, the goal is to make all of our x's disappear whenever we're doing integration by substitution, and that's what happened. Boom, boom. So I can rewrite this out as the integral between 0 and 2 of e to the u du. Now we integrate with respect to u, so the integral of e to the u with respect to u is e to the u. But here's where we have to be careful. My limits of integration are 0 and 2, but x is 0 and x is 2, which means I'm not going to just plug in 0 and 2 right now. I can't do that. I'm going to substitute u back in. Now, usually we would put plus c and end the problem there, but not in this case. We have e to the 4x minus x, 4x squared minus x, where my limits of integration are 2 and 0. Okay. So I'm going to say e to the 4 times 2 squared minus 2 minus, I'm going to give myself a little bit more space, e to the 4, 0 squared minus 0. A little bit of quick math. That's 16 minus 2, so that's 14. E to the 14 minus e to the 0. So my final answer is going to be whatever e to the 14 is, minus 1. Cool, huh? I think so. I wonder how well you can see my face. Another integral here. Another integration using u substitution here. And it looks like if I took the derivative of u, I would get something close to that one. So I'm going to let u equal 3 minus 10x cubed. So the derivative of that, du dx, is going to be negative 30x squared. Do the old switcheroo. Du over negative 30x squared equals dx. And substitute. I can rewrite this guy as the integral between negative 2 and 2. X squared doesn't change. This guy, though, becomes u to the 4th. Du over negative 30x squared. X squareds cancel out. Bada bing, bada bang. And I'm going to bring that negative 30 over. Bring it out. Put it on the bottom. Put a 1 on top of it. And so now I have the integral between 2 and negative 2 of u to the 4th du. So you integrate with respect to u. And when you do that, that gives you 1 over negative 30. 1 over 4 plus 1, which is 5. U to the 4 plus 1, which is 5. And my limits of integration are the x values, negative 2 and positive 2. Now I put those x's there. Because I need to substitute u back in. So, moving this over here a little bit more, I don't need that negative on the bottom, I'll just bring it out. 1/5 u, which is 3 minus 10x cubed to the 5th. No. Or I'm going to plug in negative 2 and I'm going to plug in 2. Maybe one more step. One more step. I'll just multiply those two together. All I did was multiply the fractions there. Oh, can't forget that. Would change pretty much everything. You probably want a calculator for this one. Okay. So I have negative 1 over 50, 150, 3 minus 10, and 2 cubed to the 5th. Minus 150, 3 minus 10, negative 2 cubed to the 5th. Three minus 10 times 8.
It's negative 77.
Negative 77 to the 5th power. Negative 77 to the 5th power.
Negative 77 raised to the 5th power is negative 2,706,784,157.
So, 2, 7. opposed, 6, 7, 8, 4, 1, 5, 7, over 1. Okay, that was fun. Minus 3 minus negative 10 times negative 8. 3 minus negative 10 times negative 8.
It's negative 77.
Did I make a mistake? Oh, I see what I did. 3 minus 10 times negative 8.
It's 83.
83 to the third power.
83 raised to the third power is 571,787.
It's supposed to be to the fifth power, duh. 83 to the fifth power.
83 raised to the fifth power is
3,939,040,643. 2706784157 minus 3939040643.
It's negative 1,232,256,486.
Gross. Which means we have more negative stuff. We have more action happening underneath the x-axis than above. What a terrible problem I chose. Good job, me. But we did it, and we had fun. Some good old trig. We've got something inside this cosine right there. Which means I can't take the regular old integral. What I have to do is I have to say, well, let's let u equal pi x, which means the derivative is going to be just pi because pi is a number. And once you do the old switcheroo, you get that. So far, so good. So far, so good. So let's do, just like any terrible movie, we're going to do a rewrite. The integral between 0 and a half of 2 cosine x pi is u now, so cos u du over pi. So nothing's going to get crossed out here. Nothing's going to get crossed out like we usually see. What I am going to do is I'm going to bring that 2 out in front, this one right here, and I'm going to bring that over pi out in front as well. The integral of cosine u with respect to u is just regular sine, no negative, just regular old sine. So I have 2 over pi sine u, limits of integration are a half. Now keep in mind, that's my x, and I forgot to write it out. My x values are a half and 0. So I have to plug my u back in, and that was pi x. It's pi times x means half of x, half of pi minus 2 over pi sine 0. What's sine of half a pi?
Here's what I found.
Sine of half pi.
Here's what I found.
This should be easier than this. Calculate sine of half pi.
Here's what I found.
Okay, so sine is one. So this whole thing becomes one. So that becomes that. Sine of 0.
The answer is 0.
Oh, and that becomes 0. So my final answer is 2 over pi. Well, looky there. Who would have thought? 2 over pi. Great. All right, so usually when you do a crazy problem like this and you see integration by substitution, you're more or less looking for functions within a function. And if your thing inside the function is a regular old x, then you're probably, if it's what it's supposed to be, you're in good shape. This guy, on the other hand, is problematic. But I'm not sad, because I'm thinking, well, that's probably, that sine x is probably going to be my u, and the derivative of sine x is going to be cos x. So look at there, good thought. U is sine x. So du dx is cos x. Do the old switcheroo. Rewrite the integral of pi over 2. Between negative pi over 2 and negative pi of cosine x cosine u dx, which is now du over cos x by so this becomes the integral. Limits of integration are negative pi over 2 and negative pi, regular pi over 2 and negative pi, of cos u du. As we remember, the integral of cosine, actually, if I'm going to take the integration, I don't need that guy anymore. The integration, or the integral of cosine is regular sine, no negatives, of u, where my limits of integration are pi over 2 and negative pi. What was u? Sine x? So, I have sine x. No. Separately. Well, that was kind of a waste of time. Limits of integration. Pi over 2. Negative pi. have sine of pi over 2 minus sine of negative pi. So I already know that sine of pi over 2 is 1. So this part becomes 1. So sine of 1 minus sine of negative pi sine 1.
I didn't get that.
Yeah, you would. So sine 1 is 0.8415 minus sine of 0, which I believe is pi. It's 0! So our final answer is 0.8415. Fun! And that's it. Bye!